today. Hallelujah. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord today? Let's stand and worship. Amen.
Tries to steal what you say, saying I have no reason to praise. I will give thanks. I will give thanks. When the roar that I hear is the voice of my fear, trying to silence this hope in my heart, I will give thanks. I will give thanks. A song of thanksgiving is my battle cry. With joy as my weapon, I'll stand and defy the lie of the dark with my hands lifted to the sky. I will rejoice. I will rejoice. I will dance in your kindness and claim every yes and amen. I will rejoice, I will rejoice. I will shout up your goodness forever again and again. When it's all stripped away and it seems it's too late, hope is buried and dead in the grave, I'll speak your name. Speak your name. A song of thanksgiving is my battle cry. With joy is my weapon, I'll stand and defy the lie of the dark with my hands lifted to the sky. I believe joy.
Stop. Great.
shoulders. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Singing this morning. It's the very breath of the living God breathing inside of us. We don't want just God to breathe in us. We want God to live, breathe, and dwell in the very depths of our soul this morning. I don't know what lie the enemy has told you. I don't know if the enemy has told you that you're not good enough, that you're never going to be used, that you are not worthy. But I'm here to tell you there's a God that wants to breathe life. The very same God that breathed life to Adam. The very same God that raised Lazarus from the grave. The very same God that rose Jesus is the very same God, the very same power that's living in each and one of us. So this morning, we need to stop saying amen to the enemy when he tells us you're not worthy. We need to stop saying amen. Because God has called us to be more than a conqueror. God has gave us the authority to be overcomers and walk in his purpose. But if we continue to say amen to every lie the enemy brings into our life, we're never going to walk in the purpose of our God. So this morning, I encourage you, the altars are open. Allow the Holy Spirit to minister and move and speak into your life like never before. So this morning, God, we just come before you. We ask you that you will breathe life into the visions and the dreams that the enemy has tried to steal and destroy from each and one of us. I pray that you will move, that we will experience and encounter your love and your presence this morning. Can you do the bridge one more time? All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise into your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord.
Here. Family standing and we're asking and we're fighting with Pastor Larry alongside with him. I pray, Lord God, that you would just do a miracle in his body right now. Touch him where he's at, Lord Father God. Heal him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet, Lord. And I pray for his family, Lord God, that you would just put a peace in their hearts and their mind, Lord. I pray for every single person that's up here for sickness, for whatever it is, Lord God, whether it's a family member for Lorena, Lord Father God, I pray for her family, for peace, Lord God, for a healing in her mom right now in Jesus' name. I pray and I rebuke you, devil, right now in the name of Jesus, to take your hands off of her family and her mom. In the name of Jesus, Lord God, I pray for complete healing right now in Jesus' mighty name. Lord, and I ask for everybody else here, everybody else that's in this church, if you're feeling sick, if you're going through something, whatever it is, I pray for your peace and your touch in him, Lord Father God, to just touch him. In Jesus' name we pray, Lord. Amen. If you guys need to continue to keep on praying, just keep on praying. God's going to do a miracle. Watch. We're going to have people coming up here with testimonies of God doing a miracle, Lorena. God's going to do it. And through that, God's going to save your family. You stand on that. Amen. Oh, you guys can greet each other.
Turn around, say hi to somebody, welcome somebody in. The kids are getting ready to gather over to my left, your right. They're going to go over and into their classes right on the other side. Amen.
Champion, oh, there is power, so much power in his blood. He holds the keys to freedom, he trampled death and grave. The demons trembled when he rolled the stone away. The Lord is our salvation, he is our champion.
Good morning, church. Good morning. Good to see everybody here. Well, I'm doing the tithes and offering. As you can see on the, there's three ways you can give. Text to give. There's a kiosk in the back. And then you can give in the envelope. And then on the church app. I don't know if you guys, I know pretty much a lot of people here, but a lot of people don't know what I do. I work for a builder. And the theme of this month is build, or this whole year so far has been build. Well, you know, a builder, what they do is they have investors that give so you can see communities grow, right? And I look at the kingdom the same way, as we give to see people grow in the Lord and see people get saved. And that's why we give. It's, you know, it's not just because your pastor's got a nice fancy car or nothing like that. It's because we can have things so we can invite people to church and see the kingdom of heaven grow. And that's the whole purpose, is we want to see people saved. We want to see when God comes, he takes all his people. It's the same thing with the builder. They invest so they can see communities grow, right? So I'm going to read a verse. You know, it's Psalms 27. We trust in the name of the Lord our God. And, you know, when was the last time you gave in such a way that you like trust, that you trusting in the Lord to provide your needs? And like Sister Janet always says, sometimes when we're struggling, when we give, to give our way out is we give when we don't have. And God provides. God always provides. And that's what we do, is we ask God to provide for that we can be able to establish his kingdom. And, you know, so I'm going to pray that, you know, this deep, just reach down deep, and we want to be able to see people get saved, and, you know, we can grow out of this school and see more lives get touched by God, right? Father God, I just come to you, Lord Father God. I thank you for meeting the need, Lord Father God. I pray that, Lord Father God, that you would touch these people right here in our church right now, Lord Father God. As we give, Lord Father God, it furthers your kingdom, Lord Father God, that your will be done, Lord Father God, and new souls, Lord Father God. And I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Ralph. All right. Good morning, everyone. I have a couple prop stuff. Hey, Rudy, can you help, give me a hand on that stair thing back there? There's like a horn-looking thing, or Isaac, and then like a cup. Can you bring that over here, please? Sorry, I'm on like triple duty this morning. Went from drumming to preaching to doing stuff, so my head's a little bit everywhere right now. But praise God, I'll put this here. Make it all crazy. Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Give it up for Isaac, everyone. Hey. Don't expect any magic tricks. I'm not here. So, but yeah, we're going to continue on our theme of build. And so bless you. See, from all the way from here. And so I want to kind of put the thought today, this morning, about, you know, continuing this theme of build. And what piece of furniture is the center of your home? Anybody give me some couple ideas? Anybody out there? Couch. Oh, okay, that's a good one. TV. Oh, yeah. I forgot. You're young. Yeah. Television. Yeah. What's that? Kitchen. Yeah. Someone said table. Who said table? All right. I said a couple of them. So that's what I want to be talking about today, is the table. At our house, if you've ever been to my house, you walk into our door, and the first thing you see is our dining table. For us, it's very important. That's where all our community happens, in our house. We have, you know, we're, I work, you know, work from home, thank God, and my kids are homeschooled, and my wife works home, so we all work together, which is a blessing and sometimes a curse, because we get on each other's nerves. But the cool thing about it is the table is a central place where we communicate. So we have lunch together, we have dinner together, we have friends over, we have loved ones over, family over, and it usually gravitates around the table, you know. And I know, like, it's crazy. I know, like, this young buck right here, Jesse, but the invention of the television kind of shifted the attention of the table to in many homes. But for much of human history, you know, what you wanted to show off was a table. How big was your table, right? That was like the it wasn't a Lexus, it wasn't a, you know, two-story, million-bedroom home. It was a table. That was the centerpiece. And why? It's because life always happens around the table, right? That's to me, to our house, that's very important. I remember when Andrew and I, we were newlyweds, and we got our first apartment. And I remember we went to IKEA, and we, you know, we purchased this table. And this table wasn't nothing fancy, because our apartment was small, but it collapsed. It kind of, like, it was like a circle, half circle, we put it against the wall, and it just had two little stools, just for me and her, right? And I remember we had a furniture building party at my house. It had friends over, and they were helping us build a bed, build dressers, and all this stuff, you know, furniture and stuff. And I remember, like, we ordered pizza for our friends, and we put on this little small table. It's like a little bit bigger than this table. And we didn't even have plates out, because we didn't even find them or anything. But the fact is, the fact that we all still congregate around this little table. So it's very much like a part of our lives. And I want you guys to know that even though a table might be small or whatever, like in my house, you're welcomed. And that's what a table represented in my family. And in God's house, there is a table. And we are all welcomed at that table. And in God's, and then the Lord's table happens to be at the Lord's house. And in God's house, there is to be a table. I'm going through this a lot because I want you guys to get this. Because in God's house, where there's a table, that's where life happens. Life revolves around that table. So when we look at a table this morning, I want to show you where we are set to be at. What we are able to receive. And then I want you to be invited to come with me to this table. At the table, Israel was set before God in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, at the table, us, the church, we are set before God to offer our lives to Him. See, at the table, it's not about you. It's about what you bring. It's, you know, and then if you were to build a table, how many of you guys ever put a table together? Right? Isn't it odd that to put a table together, you got to kind of start backwards? You have to flip it upside down. You have to start with the foundation. You got to start with the legs. And the legs have to be equally proportioned to each other, or else you're going to have a wobbly table. And then once you get the legs figured out, then you put the top on. And then when you put the top on, then you're not done. You're like, okay, well, I built this table that has to be equal, right? And I feel like sometimes that's how the church is. There's a table here, but we're not proportioned to each other. We're not equally holding the weight. So in this table is wobbly. Right? And so, not only that, but once you built this table, once you figure that out, to this morning, we're going to figure it out, guys. We're going to figure out why this table is wobbly. Let's talk about it. And so once we figure it out, so once you built this table, then you flip it, right? Then you figure out where you're going to put it. And you find a place to put it, right? You think long and hard where this table is going to sit. And then you start realizing that building the table really wasn't about the table. Because then your mindset is on the next thing. What am I going to set on top of it? What's going to be presented at my table? And then you go even further. It's like, man, all right, I got this table. I took time to buy the plates, the bowls, et cetera, the runner, all this stuff. Then you'd be like, who's going to sit at this table? Who are you allowing to sit at this table? Right? Who are we allowing? So like this whole thing, this whole year, we've been literally, since the beginning of the year, we've been talking about build. We haven't diverted. We haven't shifted. It's been about this. Because we all know how important it is to build something on a solid foundation, much like that table. If the legs are not even, the table is useless. Right? You guys ever been to, like, a restaurant, a table's wobbly? And I know if you're like my wife, you're like, you know, she's like, it drives her nuts. Right? And so when we do that, a table is the same way it is to the church of God, like us, the kingdom of God. We all have an equal role to play, right? And so once all that happens, like, there's a purpose to this table. And it's not just for show. And so, like, I want to dive into something in the scriptures. If you guys all have your Bibles, you can turn it on, you can turn to the page, whatever digital format you have or whatever. But let's go to Psalm 23. Because we read this psalm, like, if you guys were around me a couple weeks ago, a very good friend of mine that led to the Lord years ago passed away. His funeral was Wednesday. And so I got the blessing to be a part of the eulogy and to speak and to share and to minister at his funeral. But one thing that was wild is that, you know, we use this psalm as like a somber thing. So Psalm 23 starts like this, and it'll be up there. It says, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Man. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Come on. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We've been talking about building this house. We've been talking about this temple. We've been talking about building a characteristic of worship and all this stuff. But here, David, he kind of says a lot of things are happening. See, David tells us how God sustained him in this scripture, how God sustained him. And I want to look at this today. Specifically, verse 23, verse 5. Go back to that other, the whole thing. Yeah, right there. It's fine. But I highlighted that on purpose. It says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. See, God often uses material things or metaphors to speak to us about spiritual things. And here God uses three things I want to point out this morning that we can touch and handle. First is a table, right here. There's a table right here. The second one is like a cup. This might look funky. I'll get to it, but there's oil in here. And so the table, God sustains by giving strength. The table represents that. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. That's verse 5. You can put verse 5 up there, please. Now, this is eating in style, guys. Forget grabbing a double-double after this on the drive-thru and eating it on your way home, right? Just getting all, you got lettuce, you got all this stuff all over your shirt. No, I'm not talking like that. Talking about table, you know, if you guys go all out during Thanksgiving, this is the kind of feast that David's writing about. The table is spread, so you can imagine your family's goes all out. But I can imagine that there's flowers, that there's candles, that there's a platter loaded with turkey, whatever, ham, whatever this big meat. There's bowls filled with sides and all the fixings and all that stuff. But see, the thing that David says is someone prepare that table. David says, you prepare a table before me. So I want you to think of this in your mind. Paint this picture. You arrive home after a hard day of school or work. You're tired. You're annoyed because people messed you up. People got on your nerves. Your energy is spent. And then someone's in the kitchen cooking up a feast. So you say, yo, let me help. Let me help. But the person says, nah, chill. So I love Anthony, because Anthony's a chill. Anthony's like, I'm like, Anthony, Anthony's like, nah, man, you're going to screw it up, Javi. Just relax, sit down, enjoy the food. So praise God for Anthony, right? But he says, nah, chill. You sit down. Let me prepare all this feast for you. So you sit down. And then only when you sit down, you watch this person work hard, sweat, do everything by himself. And this person prepares a meal before you. You're watching. If you've been to like Benihana and all this, clink, 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 clink. This is what this person's doing. But when it's done, they'll try and go, cling, 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 or, hey, get over here. Well, I don't know, however that works in your house. You come to this table, and you sit, and you eat. And when you eat, your strength is renewed, right? That's the picture that David's painting here. So who would do that for you? David says, the person who does this for me is the Lord himself. That you prepare a table before me. Notice, I want you to notice this. It says, you prepare a table for me before me in the presence of my enemies. You prepare. That is not past tense. That is not an assumption statement. What David's saying is you currently are preparing something. So in the midst of David's life, in the midst of David's hardship, in the midst of David's mental health issues, in the midst of all the things David's facing, this verse in time spans in the present tense. It's currently being spoken. So David says that the Lord does this right now. He is doing it right now. So this is not something that God did a long time ago. It's not even what God is going to do in a little bit. It's ahorita, right now. So God uses this picture to tell you that he will sustain you by giving you strength. And as your body is strengthened by an awesome spiritual meal, which is the word of God, so you will be sustained as the Lord himself feeds you. But there's something else here. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. See, David's life was an unrelenting battle. In his early years, he was a shepherd. And not only that, he was despised by his brothers. He was the dumb, annoying little brother. So they just said, hey, man, just go watch sheep till you get bored, right? So that's what he did for a long time. Then, in his young adult 8 years, he lived as a fugitive. He was hunted, wanted by the king of Israel, King Saul. And then, when he became king himself, he inherited, because Saul was a screw-up, he inherited a divided kingdom where the tribes were in rivalry of each other, and they were filled with this seething resentment for each other. And because of that, each tribe alienated themselves because of this deep distrust they had for the nation of Israel. And later, man, that sounds like a really bad life, right? Then later, it gets better. David suffered as his family was torn apart by the cycles of abuse, violence, and death. And at one point, David himself had to flee for his life because his own son led a rebellion against him. This is the author of this psalm. You want to talk about issues? Let's talk about issues. Who got issues here? Raise your hand. You guys, oh man, it's only 10. It's like a tithe. It's like a tenth. Bunch of liars, man. Bunch of liars. It's all right though. We'll say that for the altar call. Get right. Get right or get left. Dude, shh. Not blame. But this is what David's saying here. God prepared a table. So, in spite of his burdens, the many pressures that he faced, the conflicts and the troubles that he's going through, let's flip that. What about you? All the pressures that you're going through, all the burdens, all the conflicts, all the troubles in your life, God prepares a table for you. He renewed David's strength even in the presence of his enemies, in the presence of his issues, in the presence of his battles, his trials, and tribulations. The Lord prepares a table for you in the midst of whatever is going on in your life. God gives strength to you. He will sustain you in a world that's chaotic and full of trouble. The Lord prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies. Now, I don't understand. You'd rather sit, cry, mope, complain, instead of sitting at the table where God already is giving you strength. Go in right now. So what happens is that God has a table, right? Then this is where the oil comes in. God sustains you by giving you purpose. He anoints your head with oil. Oil was used in the Old Testament to commission certain people, right? for the work God had called them to do. Those were the prophets, those were the priests, they were the kings, they were all anointed because God had given them a specific assignment. If the table speaks of new strength, the oil speaks of purpose. Now, I don't know about you, but the Bible describes us as a royal priesthood. That there's anointing that comes with that. And when you lack anointing, you better check yourself. Are you in that royal lineage of being a priesthood? And so the beautiful description is, when I read about it, is Aaron was anointed with oil. The very first priest, the very first technical person, was anointed with oil as a sign that God had chosen him to serve as a high priest. So Psalm 133, two verses, says this: "Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity." This is David writing this about Aaron. "It is like a precious oil on the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robe." Now, there's an oil that's given, right? And it runs, right? See, this is not a little oil. This wasn't like a little, like we normally do. This was oil that was poured out, right? Poured out, right? All the way. And it just kept going and going. It got messy. You guys know that when God calls you to anoint you with oil, it's messy. You're not here to look pretty. You're not here to look handsome. Because in the kingdom of God, it's not about show, it's about go. Right? So it runs all over him. It dripped on his collar, soaked all over his clothes. And David says this: "You anoint," and back to Psalm 23, "You anoint my head with oil." He must surely have had in mind the day when he was king. See, he was prophesied to be king of Israel. Then he was hijacked by this evil dictator guy, King Saul. But the prophet Samuel came to him and anointed David as a kid, anointed him. So when David's saying this, check this out. He's talking present time of a time where there was a word said about him. There was a prophecy said about him that had not yet come to pass. And yet, he didn't sit, mope, and cry. He said, presently, when he wrote this, he's a fugitive. Can you imagine being called? God has a specific word for you. You were told something specifically that the Lord was going to do, and it has not come to pass, and has gone completely 180 of what you were told to do. But instead of crying, instead of saying, "Woe is me," he says, "Lord, my cup overflows. You anoint me." Don't be a crybaby. The oil speaks of God giving purpose, a calling, an assignment, right? And so, in the Old Testament, only a few people were anointed with oil. But in the New Testament, all of God's people were anointed with the Holy Spirit. What does that mean? That means that each and every one of us has a purpose. Much like David was sustained by God, God has given us. I want you guys to say, God has given me work to do. I want you to say this with me. I've been called. I've been anointed. See, now we're on the same boat now. Now don't say that. If you lose sight of why you are here, and I'm not talking about present in church, I'm talking in your spiritual position. If you lose sense of why you are here, and what God has called you to do, you will soon get tired. You will soon get jaded. You will soon get drained, and you will get spent. See, when you serve the Lord correctly through the Holy Spirit, there is no burnout. There are frustrations? Oh, yeah. There's annoyances? For sure. There's people that drive you crazy? Of course. But do you stop serving the Lord?
No.
Why? Because in the midst of all you guys driving me crazy because I'm one of the pastors here, my cup overflows with joy. The Lord set the table before me in the presence of not only my problems, but your problems that we have to deal with. We count it all joy. Why? Because there's an anointing that comes with the call of God. It's not just a chair that you sit on. There's a character that God's putting inside of you to build you up, right? And not only that, then when the anointing comes, it comes with good news. How many of you guys ever had a bad gospel preached to you? Nah, you're not here because someone preached a bad gospel. You're here because someone gave you the good news. And what is the good news? The good news is that God has work for you to do. Yes, Lord, I'm on your team. All right, homie, you're on the team. Batter up. Right? Ephesians 2:10 says this. This is for you guys right here. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand. So God already has stuff for you to do. And we should walk in them. Present. Walk in them. Not walk. Not I'm going to walk, but I'm walking in them. See, God has work for you to do currently at this state in your life. If your life is jacked up, it's all good. We'll figure that out with the Lord. But guess what? You keep on walking. You keep on walking. You get to stepping. Right? And I want you to find out. So if you're getting jaded, if you're getting burned out, if you feel like you've lost the step, you know what I'm saying? Let me give you this tip. Find out this morning, afterward, find out during, ask the Lord right now, ask the Holy Spirit, God, what is it you're called me to do? And then be quiet. And be still and know that he is God. And see what he says. And once he says that, pursue it relentlessly. And as you do, God will sustain you. God might not give you all the 411, all the info right away, but God will give you enough to get the step in, and as you go, he will sustain you. This is what Christians are missing, that they feel like they want all the revelation. When you want the revelation, read the book. God's not calling us to have all the revelation. God has called us to have all the obedience. If you wanted to know everything God wanted to know, guess what? You're on earth. You're not in heaven, so you're not going to know it all. Two, it's already been written. You want to know about God? There's 66 books in one giant thing that tells you what God is, who God is, how he thinks, how he acts, and how he feels about you. And if you want even to go even deep further, stop looking in the mirror, stop procrastinating, and just follow what God tells you to do, and he will sustain you. Come on. So now, we got the table, we got the oil, now we go to the cup, right? God sustains you. The cup, what does the cup mean? The cup means that it overflows. The cup represents joy. See, there's a bummer version of Christianity that goes something like this. In this world, the enemies will surround you, and somehow, you will have to get through it. That's how people sometimes look at the Bible, how they look at Christianity. And you just have to endure. You have to survive, right? You have to stick it out. You have to put up with it. And if you do, you will be blessed in the end. This is what most people think of the Christianity is, right? When your life in this world is over, then maybe if you did those things, you will go to heaven, and then you will have joy. See, this Debbie Downer of Christianity boils down to this. Life sucks, but heaven is coming. But that's not what David's saying here. That's not what David said at all. David's saying is that he is a man who knew plenty of trouble in his life, and yet he says, my cup overflows. It tells us in Psalm 23 that there's a fallen world and that he suffered. We all suffer. And even now, in front of my enemies, in the presence of them, my cup overflows. And even in the dark valley, even in trials and tribulations, when I'm going through stuff, my cup overflows. When I don't feel like I'm loved, when I feel like I'm depressed, when I'm feeling anxiety, all this stuff, instead of popping pills, instead of popping all these things, guess what? My cup overflows. My cup overflows. That there's this joy in me that's not tied to how I feel. It's tied to what I know about God and what God says about me. That's what the cup is. That's what joy is, right? And I'm going to paint this picture of you guys. John 15:11 says this: in this world, you will have trouble. Come on, Jesus. You said I have joy. Nah, man. He says you will have trouble. But then Jesus says this in a chapter later. But he said, these things I have spoken to you, that my joy, whose joy? His joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. If you have no joy in your life right now, it's because that joy of his is not in you. And when you're completely empty, guess what? There's nothing that overflows. You spent. You empty. You lack joy. This is why nobody wants to be around you. This is why you're critical. This is why you're prideful, that you know more than everybody else does. This is the attitude. You know who was anointed? You know who was privileged to worship? You know who had the authority in heaven to do all these things? Satan. And he fell. You want to represent Jesus or you want to represent Satan? That's the only thing this morning. So David says this, my cup overflows. And I'm going to read you this story. There's a story about this old man and his best friend. And they are sitting in a crowded subway. And this much younger man is standing in front of him, holding onto the grab bar. And this younger man tells the older man sitting in the seat and asks him, hey, yo, what time is it? The old man refused to reply. So the young man was like, all right, that's messed up. So he moves on. The old man's friend sitting next to him says, yo, why were you so disrespectful to this young man? He was asking you a question. He asked you what time it was. The old man answered, if I had given him the time of day, next he'd want to know where I'm from. Then he wants to know where I'm going. Then we might talk about our interests. And if we did all that, then he might want to invite himself to my house for dinner. And then he'd probably meet my lovely daughter. And then if he met her, they would probably fall in love. I don't want my daughter marrying somebody that can't afford a watch. See, we are like this old man. We have a table. We have an opportunity. We have this anointing, this oil, and yet we don't want to share it with anybody else. Because Jesus prepares a place for us at this table that has a free invitation that all of us can come freely. Yet, not only that, but we refuse to invite others to sit alongside of us. See, we confuse this table that Jesus sets, we confuse this table with our table. It's my table. And this table is not your table. This church is not your church. This church is not my church. This church is not Pastor Lou's church. This church is the Lord's church. And everybody has a place at this table, at this church. So when we start confusing those things, it becomes about us. It's possessive. It's unrighteous. And we start to lose the fact that it's not our, it's not mine, it's ours. It's ours. See, the blessings of God to us in Jesus Christ is for all of us to take share. From the fullness of his grace, we have received one blessing on top of another. His grace is what keeps coming. His joy is what keeps coming. That's what keeps overflowing. So this cup, sooner or later, should start filling up. It should start overflowing. If your cup is empty, if your cup is maybe a three-quarters full or a quarter full or whatever, then you have to realize, why is my cup not overflowing? And Isaiah describes God's forgiveness. It is not enough to say that, oh, God will pardon. This is what Isaiah says. It says that God will abundantly pardon. It's not even on there, so don't even get lost in the sauce. Listen, God will abundantly pardon abundantly, overflowing pardon, forgiving us. As Isaiah says in chapter 55. Then in the psalmist, he says this again, right? Psalm 130 says this, David. He says that with the Lord, there's a plenteous redemption. And then Paul speaks not just of the riches in Christ, but the unsearchable riches of Christ, which is Ephesians 3:8, meaning that God has abundant life for us that he's willing to give us, yet we're like this old man that does not want to share. Right? John 10:10, Jesus speaks about giving us life abundantly. And when the prodigal son returned home, right, we know about the story. The father did not meet him with this reluctant grace. He wasn't like this old man. He wasn't standoffish. He didn't say, oh, so you decided to come back. I know some of you parents, you guys are foul to your kids. Oh, so you decided to come back? Have you? Well, make sure that you don't mess up again, right? No. The father embraced this wayward son. He embraced him and kissed him. And not only did he embrace and kiss him and accept him back, it says that he put a robe on his back and a ring on his finger. When the prodigal son came home, the father did not tell him, there might be a cold hot dog for you in the fridge, or go check where the dog has food. He didn't say any of that. He said, yo, get the fattest calf. Get the fattest burger. We're going to have steak tonight. Get that. And not only that, he says, I forgive you. I don't even care what you did. He literally says, you're abundantly pardoned. And when you're abundantly pardoned, guess what? He says, there's a redemption that's plentiful. Why was the father of the prodigal son like that? Why? Because his cup overflowed. His joy was in place. He knew once his lost son would come back home that there was joy. That there was joy. Man, this is what Jesus does. This is what Jesus, Benihana's, whatever he's doing. He's preparing something for you right this morning. But will you come and sit? Will you come and take your place at the table? The table, the oil, the cup. The table reminds us that God sustains us by giving us strength. The oil reminds us that God sustains us by giving us purpose. And the cup reminds us that God sustains us by giving us joy. So how do you get the strength, anointing, purpose, and joy? How do you get all this? And where do you find it? David says this. He says that we are all blessed. And with every spiritual blessing, he prophesied, will come from the Lord. And then Paul even says that, he reiterates that in Ephesians 1:3, that every blessing comes from the Lord himself. So what David lived so many years before Jesus, and then we live so many years after Jesus, but the fact is Psalm 23 talks about that there's an anointing and a cup and this table ready no matter the present time. So I'm going to have Anthony Brunsky come up real quick. I'm going to take a little bit longer because I want us to understand this real quick. But he's going to lead us in communion.
Yeah, so I'm going to head over here. And so before I go into taking communion, I kind of want to share a little something that leads into that. And so really quickly, I want you guys to all just imagine the way that what you think God thinks about you and how you think he feels about you. And so I'll just give you a few moments to kind of ponder that. And so based on what you've thought, if what you think God thinks about you or feels about you, if it doesn't come back to the core of God loving you, it's a distortion of how God truly views you. Because the reality is, the core of how God feels about you, how he thinks about you, is that he deeply loves you, and out of that comes every single thing else. Like, some of you may feel like, oh, I feel like God is disappointed with me, or I feel like God is mad at me, or he wants me to be afraid of him or anything like that. But the truth of the matter is, like, literally, whatever you've done, whatever it may be, like, the core of how God feels about you is this great, deep love. And out of every single thing else flows from that, from a great, deep love. And so as we're going into communion, this the most symbolic action of Jesus' love is him dying on the cross. Just like the Bible says, for God so loved the world, for God so loved you, that he gave his one and only son. Like, literally, God sent Jesus to die for us because of his great love for us. And that changes everything. That changes everything. And, like, if I'm being honest, like, at times, I'm like, God, do you love me? Like, I don't know. I'm questioning God's love. But when we go back to the Word, when we go back to what he's written about us, it's clear, it's evident that God deeply loves us. He deeply cares about us so much. And not just can we see it in the Word, but we can see it through what Jesus did for us. The ultimate price, the ultimate symbol of his love for us, that he went to the cross, he laid down his life for us, and he died for us. And so as we take communion, I want you guys to all come up here and take some bread, take some juice, and as we take communion, I want you guys to think and just know that at the core of what God thinks about you and how he feels about you is a great and deep love. And out of everything flows from that. And we can respond in that truth. That we can respond in worship. We can respond in spending time with him. We can respond in forgiving others because he's forgiven us out of his love. Everything he does, literally everything he does in our life, flows from his great and deep love for us. And so, yeah, if you guys want to all come up, take some bread and some juice as we take communion. And if you guys want to, and just, you can stay in the altar, because we're family, man. We're family. So as we take communion, let's join together. And remember what God has done for us.
Guys, to find your place at the altar. So we'll just come on in. You want to move on down? We can move on down or find a place. But I want you guys, it's very important that you guys meet me at the altar. Meet me up here. It's because the very first time the word worship was mentioned in the Old Testament was in Genesis, and it's regarding a table. Pretty crazy. Or a place of sacrifice, a table, a mantle, whatever you want to call it. But God tells Abraham to prepare this worship table and lay his son down, Isaac, on it. Right? You guys know what the Isaac, you know what your name means? It means joy. That's exactly. Isn't that crazy? That the words for worship is a table. And the very first time in the act was to lay something down, which was the prophetic word that was spoken over Abraham that he was going to have a child. And when he has his child Isaac, his miracle child, that he has to lay him down, he has to give him up, which means joy. That's crazy. And so you start seeing this vision that Jesus was that one and only begotten son, that is joy, and God laid him down at the altar as an act of worship, not only to obedience, but of sacrifice. This is what this bread represents. Jesus goes, this is my body, right? He paints this picture, this metaphor. This is my body, and he starts to tear it up. He starts to share it amongst the disciples. He says, my body is tethered, it's bruised, it's ripped apart. For what? For our sins. What is this? Jesus, at this altar, at this table where everyone's welcomed, he shares this excruciating deep thought, this revelation that the Father is giving him. And not only that, there's 12 members of his posse there. You know who sat there too? Judas, in the presence of his enemies. He shares this. Because everyone is welcome at God's table. So Lord, we thank you, God. Lord, for this bread that represents your body, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we have communion, which is the root of community, Lord, that we can partake this, Lord, and as we take this bread, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice, for the chastisement, the iniquity that you took upon yourself, Lord, to be bruised for our lives, Lord. We thank you, Lord, salvation, Lord, and obedience on the cross with your body, Lord, in Jesus' name. Let's go ahead and take this. And the Lord paints another picture. You know, he says that he's pouring out wine. He's saying that this represents my blood that was shed for us. The blood of Jesus, the Bible says that it cleanses us. It wipes us clean. And that was an act of worship in the Old Testament, that they would sacrifice a spotless, perfect lamb to be slaughtered. The Bible says that Jesus is that Lamb of God. And so with this blood shed, I want you guys to understand this. That when there's bloodshed upon you, that it's covered, it's protection. It symbolizes protection. I believe if you're sick this morning, that the blood of Jesus can heal you. It has healed you. I believe if you're going through troubles in your mind, you're battling things spiritually, the blood of Jesus can heal it, can heal you. That this blood is not only that, but it's a sign of covenant. It's a promise that Jesus made for you, to you. And the Bible makes it very clear that his word does not return void. What Jesus says about you is the same that he said things about people in the past. It's about you today, and it's about you in the future. You are his workmanship. You are the apple of his eye. You are the one that he loves. So as we drink this, be reminded that, Lord, thank you, God, for shedding blood, for protecting me, for letting the work be done, God, on Calvary, Lord. And God, as we drink this, Lord, may you cleanse us, God, of all the things that sustain us or deteriorate us, God, Lord, and tear us apart, God, may you sustain us, Lord. In Jesus' name. I want you guys to worship with me. I don't know if the worship team wants to join, go up there. We're going to pray for you guys. I want you guys to stay right here. We're going to anoint you guys. Pastor Lou has some oil. We're going to anoint all you guys. We're going to pray for all you guys. Because we want to release you guys. We want to have you guys fulfill your destiny in the Lord. So where's Pastor Lou at? Oh, there he is. So as we worship, just raise your hands, surrender to God. You are here. Find a spot. You know, this is the thing I love about this. That we're here as together as a family. And Lord, we just surrender ourselves, God. We surrender ourselves. If I can have leaders, Corey, we can have, I don't know if Rafaletti are here, but no, they're kids, but that's fine.